la explosión. Se perdió el hombre de este siglo allí, su nombre y su apellido son fusil contra fusil. Se quebró la cáscara del viento al sur y sobre la primera cruz despierta la verdad.
Hello and welcome. This event is being recorded. I'm Diane Stradling. I am co-hosting. This is, I'm a member of the Boston Cuba Solidarity Coalition, July 26th, which is one of the co-sponsors of this event. The coalition was formed in 1989 to oppose US government hostilities towards the Cuban Revolution and to work towards normalizing relations with Cuba. Our coalition is a member of the National Coalition, the NNOC, National Coalition on Cuba, and we take part in the Saving Lives Campaign, resolution committees, and other aspects of NNOC work. Our activities include public education programs such as this one, video events, hosting talks from visiting Cubans, report backs from those who have visited Cuba recently. We participate in humanitarian material aid campaigns, and you'll be hearing more about that a little bit later. We support delegations to Cuba. We're committed to working to end the aggressive policies to illegal sanctions of the United States towards Cuba through solidarity work and direct action. Okay. Our process for this evening for Zoom is we have people on from all across the country, from across Canada, the South, and across the pond in Europe also. I wanted to say good evening, but it's different times and different places, so I'll skip that for now. Please keep yourself, everyone is muted and we will keep you muted. Speakers view, please, if you can get on the speaker's view when the speakers are speaking so that you can see them fully. If you're going, we encourage you to put questions in the chat at any time during these presentations. Please write Q or question before your questions in case there's a lot in the chat so that we can pull that out. And please stay on until the end of the event because we have lots of information to share with you. Okay. Steve?
All right, thank you. I'm Steve Rizzo of the Boston chapter of the Democratic Socialists of America, as well as a member of DSA, or Democratic Socialists of America's International Committee. DSA is a 50-state socialist organization with upwards of 100,000 members in the United States. We are also, like July 26th, our partners in this event, members of the National Network on Cuba. Although we are just really getting started with our Cuba work in DSA. While that means we're still building up, that also means there's great opportunities to get involved with our Cuba organizing. I would also like to thank our numerous other co-sponsors and endorsers. Our co-sponsors include, in addition to July 26th Coalition and Boston DSA, Massachusetts Peace Action, First Baptist Church of Jamaica Plain in Boston, and our endorsers include New Hampshire Peace Action, Brookline PACs, and Cuba Lives from Cuba Lives from Maine. And with that, I think I'll pass it back to my colleague Diane.
Thank you, Steve. It is my honor and delight to be introducing Helen Yaffe to you this evening. Helen is a lecturer in economic and social history at the University of Glasgow and visiting fellow at the Latin American and Caribbean Center in the London School of Economics. Her teaching focuses on Latin American and Cuban development. Since 1995, she has spent time living and researching in Cuba. She's a filmmaker, Teria Vida, you'll hear about that. And her latest book is We Are Cuba, which in March was sold out and now has been reprinted. So please go to your local independent bookstore and ask for We Are Cuba. Helen, the Zoom is yours.
Thank you very much. So just start by thanking all of the organizers, particularly Diane, for inviting me along. Quite a few of you will have seen me recently, perhaps giving talks during a sort of virtual North American tour that I did in March and April, talking about Cuba's response to climate change, which I've been asked to talk about this evening, but obviously relating it to the United States blockade. When I was doing those talks, I don't want to repeat them, but I was talking about the background, providing a background in terms of necessity and capacity. So in terms of understanding the necessity for Cuba to have such a comprehensive state plan to confront climate change, we're really talking about the history of colonialism and imperialism, which brings with it the imposition of the sugar industry, which leads to terrible deforestation, as well as a dependence on food imports and so on. But post 1959, there are continuing problems with pollution and erosion, particularly the adoption of the green revolution of mechanized agriculture. Cuba also has extraordinary natural endowments and biodiversity, which it recognizes it has to protect. And it is, of course, as a small island nation, particularly vulnerable to climate change. But Cuba also has the capacity to deal with this. First, because of the social character of property, the collective values of Cuban law, and also the planned socialist economy. It has a world-recognized civil defense system and the capacity for the collection and analysis of statistical data. And very important, it has political will. The Cuban Communist Party and individuals in Cuba have got behind an environmental agenda. So to give a bit of background to that, I'd like to introduce the first clip, which is a very opportune moment. It's a clip of Fidel Castro speaking exactly 30 years and 2 days ago at the UN Earth Summit in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. At this point, Cuba had already had campaigns of reforestation. It had a constitution in 1976, which became one of the first in the world to recognize the importance of environmental protections. So if you could kindly play that, Bob.
Land ownership and control over agriculture and extractive industries are key for implementing environmental policy. After the Cuban Revolution of 1959, large land holdings were nationalized and converted into state farms, or redistributed to small farmers and cooperatives. A series of environmental laws were also introduced.
In our country since 1959, with the triumph of the Cuban Revolution, the conservation of nature became a political will. In 1976, the Constitution of the Republic of Cuba was approved, and it provided in its Article 27, the duty of the state and the society to care about the environment.
Hoy se le llama plan de Estado, pero desde muchos años siempre le ha dedicado una atención especial al tema del cambio climático y a los temas medioambientales. De hecho, desde Río de Janeiro, con las palabras de nuestro comandante en jefe, Fidel Castro, ya pone de hecho evidencia de todas las acciones y de las preocupaciones por el ser humano como elemento fundamental.
Una importante especie biológica está en riesgo de desaparecer por la rápida y progresiva liquidación de sus condiciones naturales de vida, el hombre. Es necesario señalar que las sociedades de consumo son las responsables fundamentales de la atroz destrucción del medio ambiente. Han envenenado los mares y ríos, han contaminado el aire, los bosques desaparecen, los desiertos se extienden. No es posible culpar de esto a los países del tercer mundo, colonias ayer, naciones explotadas y saqueadas hoy por un orden económico mundial injusto. La solución no puede ser impedir el desarrollo a los que más lo necesitan. Lo real es que todo lo que contribuya hoy al subdesarrollo y la pobreza constituye una violación flagrante de la ecología. Si se quiere salvar a la humanidad de esa autodestrucción, hay que distribuir mejor las riquezas y las tecnologías disponibles en el planeta. No más transferencias al tercer mundo de estilos de vida y hábitos de consumo que arruinan el medio ambiente. Páguese la deuda ecológica y no la deuda externa. Desaparezca el hambre y no el hombre. Mañana será demasiado tarde para hacer lo que debimos haber hecho hace mucho tiempo. Gracias.
Yo creo que el principal valor del discurso estuvo en poner en un contexto socioeconómico la problemática ambiental, porque a veces todo ese tema ambiental se ha visto desgajado de sus orígenes en el desarrollo capitalista, de las bases de un sistema que basado en el consumo y desmedido y en los patrones inadecuados de producción y consumo trajo hasta la realidad actual. Y el análisis de Fidel, que al final es un análisis marxista, puso eso en un contexto de las relaciones socioeconómicas y de la evolución histórica. Y eso yo creo que es lo más valioso de ese discurso. Tuvo repercusiones importantes para Cuba. Cuba modificó en ese mismo año, la 1992, la Constitución de la República, y en esa reforma constitucional introdujo el concepto del desarrollo sostenible.
Another huge step in this environmental process was the creation of the Ministry of Science, Technology and Environment. I mean, the conservation and protection of nature in our country received like a huge boost with the creation of this body.
En el viaje de retorno de Río, se vino conversando sobre la necesidad de un organismo en Cuba para atender estos temas ambientales y así surgió en pleno periodo especial, el Ministerio de Ciencia, Tecnología y Medio Ambiente. Y Fidel, en la situación más dramática tal vez que ha tenido económicamente el país en esos años del periodo especial, apostó a reforzar la agenda ambiental del país.
Another huge step in this.
Okay, so Fidel Castro was talking, Orlando Rey from SITMA was talking after Fidel Castro's speech there about the periodo especial, the special period. And many of you will know very well what that is, but just to recap, this is the name of the economic crisis following in Cuba, following the loss of 86 to 87% of trade and investment that Cuba had with the USSR and the Eastern European Socialist Bloc countries. And, you know, this affects Cuba's capacity to continue with its, it certainly cannot continue with the mechanized agricultural model. So oil imports from Russia fall from 13 million tons in 1989 to 1 million in 1991. So, you know, partly this incredible shift that takes place to organic farming without using chemical fertilizers, returning to animal traction and so on is necessity. But the point that I have made being trying to make in these talks I was given is they also had the capacity, because they were already studying organic methods because of the serious state directed investments in science and technology. So the special period hits Cuba. It means massive shortages of fuels, fertilizers, machinery, food, shortages in every sector in Cuba. And finally, at this point, Cuba feels the full impact of the United States blockade, which is something that this meeting is about. Cuba has been cushioned by the blockade. It hasn't been able to buy the most efficient productive technology from the US, but it has been able to access technologies, food, fuel, medicine, and so on through its integration into the socialist bloc. So as a response to the special period, the imperative for survival, the decision is made that Cuba will continue to be a socialist state. And quite dramatic measures are taken. State farms are divided up and turned into cooperatives. There's a whole-scale, almost whole-scale shift to organic farming and agroecology. 1994, SITMA was set up. That was the ministry they talked about in the interview of the lawyer at the end of the clip there, the Ministry of Science, Technology and the Environment. And then you have 1997, a national environment strategy, a series of legislation and actions to increase protection and conservation, and something called the Energy Revolution of 2004-05, which includes energy efficiency, energy saving, and a shift to renewable energies. And there's a whole chapter on that in my book. And then from that period, 2006, Cuba starts to get recognized globally as a leader in sustainable development. So it's raising the living standard of the population at the same time as living within the carrying capacity of its environment. And Cuba today is responsible for 0.08% of global CO2 emissions. But that does not exempt Cuba from the existential threat of climate change. In fact, as a small island nation, Cuba is one of the most vulnerable nations. So this brings us now to Tarea Vida. Tarea Vida is known as Tarea Vida, life task in English, is actually, the full name is the State Plan to Confront Climate Change. And it's a culmination of all these decades of environmental protections, of increasing legislation, of recognition of the biodiversity, of the capacity of Cuba's civil defense, which we've seen recently in the last few weeks with a series of...
Sorry, folks, I think this is a connectivity issue.
Oh, thanks. Yes, the screen froze.
Hi, I completely disappeared. The whole Zoom shut down. I don't know how that happened. It must have been my connection. So I'm back. You can all hear me and see me, yes?
Yes, yes.
It was mid-flow. Okay, so Tarea Vida, the whole island is vulnerable, but they have limited resources. So they have to prioritize. And the basis of how they prioritize are, first of all, actions to preserve lives. Secondly, actions to preserve natural space, which is necessary to guarantee physical and food security. And third, zones with tourist developments, which of course is a very important source of revenue for the island. So what they did is they identified at-risk populations and regions, and they formulated a hierarchy of what's called strategies and tasks. There's 5 strategies, 12 tasks, through which these are, strategies and tasks through which climate scientists ecologists, social scientists work alongside local communities, specialists and authorities to adapt to the specific threats and new conditions. So this means that Tarea Bida is divided into different timescales. The short timescale was 2017 to 2020. That's already passed. And the results of that have come in and they are being analyzed. The medium scale is to 2030, long is 2050, and the very long scale takes the state plan to the end of the century. So Cuba is the only country in the world with a state plan that is genuinely long-term and focuses on adaptation rather than mitigation, which is a focus for often there's more incentive for private corporations because there might be money behind that. This involves putting resources in local areas. So Tarea Bida works alongside a more general process, a development strategy to decentralize budgets, decision-making control to local areas. And so it's perceived as a new basis of development, a cultural change and a broader process of decentralization, as I've said. Now, I was also asked to talk about how the US blockade obstructs Cuba's capacity to respond to development challenges and existential threats. So, in every walk of life, as I said, the US blockade impacts, it obstructs Cuba's access to international finance, to multilateral development banks, which is really important because the kind of technology and investments that are needed for climate adaptation and mitigation require huge investments and access to capital to make them. It also stops Cuba even accessing green finance. It impedes the island's access to technology, the international banking system, and international trade. So I'm going to ask Bob to now put the second clip from the documentary about how the US blockade, first of all, how the Cubans feel about the group of Cubans feel about the US blockade and how they resist, but also how it impacts Cuba's capacity to confront climate change specifically. So Bob, if you could do that.
Entonces nosotros tenemos que primero tenemos un programa, ya tenemos un programa donde hay que ir al transporte con fuentes renovables en ella. Que podemos. Y tenemos también que ir al uso de las fuentes naturales de energía que también podemos. ¿Cuál es nuestro gran problema? Nuestro gran problema es el bloqueo. El bloqueo, por eso es que no podemos caminar más rápido.
Ya más de 60 años de bloqueo. En estos momentos muy incrementado, la administración de Trump ha hecho mucho daño y todavía Biden no muestra, a pesar de que lo dijo en su campaña electoral, nada por aflojar las medidas. Y tiene el país en situación muy difícil porque, aunque muchos piensen que no, hay una persecución real.
Si quieren ayudar a nuestro país realmente, como lo dicen, que se elimine definitivamente el bloqueo contra nuestro país. Somos un pueblo listo para combatir junto a Fidel, a Raúl, a Canel y a todos los revolucionarios que vamos a defender nuestras conquistas al precio que sea necesario.
Defendemos la paz. La paz y que quiten el bloqueo, que es asesino y criminal. La experiencia de la obra
que nos legó el comandante. Y nos merecemos trabajar sin presiones. Nos merecemos ser libres. Libres para nuestro comercio, libres para comprar más medicamentos, para que nuestra vida social tenga armonía, tengamos calidad de vida. Eso se lo merece el pueblo de Cuba.
Si realmente quiere ayudar a Cuba, levanta el bloqueo, levanta las sanciones. No es tan complicado, es solo un pueblo que quiere valerse por sí mismo y lograr desarrollarse. Simplemente eso. No más agresiones, solamente levanta el bloqueo.
Otro reto fundamental es dentro de la ciencia, adquirir nuevas tecnologías que hoy existen para muchas de las acciones que hacemos, pero que evidentemente para Cuba, dado el propio bloqueo, están afectados fundamentalmente nuestros científicos. Muchas veces resultados que pudiéramos dar en un periodo determinado se nos prolonga en el tiempo y es precisamente por esta situación.
Usted pudiera en condiciones normales adquirir un equipo de alerta temprana en Estados Unidos. No puede hacerlo, tiene que irlo a buscar a China, a Rusia o a otra latitud. Con todo lo que implica en costo, tenemos limitaciones importantes en el acceso al financiamiento externo, en buena medida debido a la política de bloqueo. Un caso típico es que nosotros no podemos acceder a los bancos multilaterales de desarrollo. Dependemos de la cooperación bilateral, dependemos del sistema de Naciones Unidas, pero nuestras opciones son mucho más limitadas que las de cualquier país. Incluso accediendo a las fuentes en que conceptualmente podemos, porque no están limitadas por el bloqueo, internamente sí lo están, porque los eventuales socios para hacer actividades con Cuba también reciben las presiones de bloqueo, por si hace falta adquirir bienes o artículos que tienen que ver con Estados Unidos, tienen parte, tienen integrantes, ya entonces vuelven a regir las normas de bloqueo, y eso crea condiciones muy difíciles para la colaboración internacional. Incluso cuando acudimos a fondos que tienen que darnos esa financiación, como es el caso del Fondo Verde del Clima, en la más reciente votación del proyecto de Cuba que se aprobó en el mes de mayo en ese fondo, Estados Unidos se opuso al proyecto como parte de la Junta.
Yo creo que el que hayamos podido acceder a los fondos...
Thank you. So I think I've nearly run out of my time, but I'm just going to say some really quick overview things about the US blockade, because we have been talking about anniversaries and marking dates. In February, there was another anniversary, and that was the 60th anniversary of the full implementation of the US blockade, or embargo, as they call it. So since the beginning of, since the revolution of 59 and the United States response, economic sanctions have been the weapon of choice for administrations in Washington. And, you know, this really is demonstrated by this sort of foundational document by an advisor to the government on the 6th of April, 1960, Lester Mallory wrote that the only foreseeable means of alienating internal support in Cuba is through disenchantment and disaffection based on economic dissatisfaction and hardship. The embargo or blockade of Cuba constitutes the longest and most comprehensive set of sanctions in modern history. It is not merely a legal or bilateral issue, as its proponents often claim. It is a key instrument in the United States toolkit to pursue regime change on the island. It is an act of war, a violation of human rights designed to obstruct Cuban development, as we were hearing in the documentary, to undermine its example as a revolutionary alternative and to intentionally cause suffering among the Cuban people. And anyone who has been to Cuba in the last couple of years will have witnessed that. If there is any Cubans here, they will know that from their own experiences in Cuba. Daniel will be talking about that, I hope, or from their families who are really going through an incredibly hard time externally imposed, notwithstanding any issues that may be internal. But we have to be clear about the root of these problems. While the pretext for US sanctions against Cuba has changed over six decades, the objectives have not. And all of these points I can expand on in the discussion. The blockade is six main legal statutes. They are broad and indiscriminate. But in addition, particularly since the 1990s, we've seen the US administration use so-called blacklists or smart sanctions, targeted sanctions. So there's currently three major lists. First is OFAC, specially designated nationals and blocked persons list. Second is the list of restricted entities and sub-entities associated with Cuba, which, as we know, was introduced by Trump in 2017, and the third is the Cuba prohibited accommodation list introduced just in 2020. Sanctions are designed since the beginning to target key economic sectors in Cuba, so tourism and biotech, whatever it was at that point, and really importantly, to scare away foreign investors. So what can be done about it? I hope we'll have some discussion about that in the meeting. In Europe, there is a new campaign that is about to be launched about European banks implementing US unilateral sanctions in violation of their own EU, and for example, in the UK, UK domestic law, which says that's illegal. So there will be a campaign campaigning against banks who have put Cuba on their list of sanctioned countries to try and make the cost of imposing unilateral US sanctions higher than the threat of fines and so on from OFAC in the US Treasury. So I hope that there will be an equivalent campaign that can be really catalyzed from this meeting, because we have to be clear that Cuba has so many inspirational development projects, like its response to climate change, which are being majorly impeded and obstructed because of US sanctions, which are designed to really suffocate the island and the Cuban people. I'll stop there.
Thank you, Helen, so very much. The blockade has strangled Cuba and in so many ways, and we learn more about it every single day. So thank you very, very much. If anyone has any questions, we're going to have the question and answer period after both of our speakers. So please put them in the chat and we will save them for then. So thank you again, Helen. And I'm turning it over to Steve now.
Thank you, Diane, and thank you, Helen. I am really thrilled to introduce to you today Daniel Montero, from a journalist and producer with Belly of the Beast, a media outlet based in Cuba. And Daniel is actually calling us from Havana today. Without further ado, we'll let him go. And we also have a short clip, I believe, also to introduce Belly of the Beast's work, which I would highly recommend, and especially the War on Cuba series. So, Daniel, do you want to say a few words of introduction first, or should we just roll?
Go ahead with the video, and I'll speak after. Thank you.
This was a tough year for us here in Cuba, and it's finally over. So, what are Cubans saying about 2021, and what are their hopes for 2022?
¿Cómo ha sido el 2021 para los cubanos?
Este año bastante difícil.
Complicado.
Todo malísimo y todo carísimo.
El año pasado estuvo crítico porque todo estaba perdido, no había nada.
Mucha escasez de todo.
Mucho esfuerzo, mucho sacrificio en el tema de salir a buscar la comida a mis hijos.
Buenas.
Yo la pasé un poco más porque no podía trabajar.
Lejos de la escuela, de los amigos.
Lo más difícil ha sido esta pandemia que nos acaba ahí.
Para los músicos ha sido terrible porque no hemos tenido trabajo.
La vida es así, si me muero por ti.
Esta crisis ha sido con respecto principalmente a este presidente que tenía Estados Unidos, Donald Trump, que ha puesto malo todo. Don Biden no ha hecho nada. De todo lo que él dijo, no ha hecho absolutamente nada.
Siempre nos ha estado obviando el tema del bloqueo, pero la pandemia le puso el punto.
Buenos días.
Sé que la vida es difícil, no aquí, en cualquier país con esta pandemia, y más nosotros que tenemos esas leyes que nos ponen el gobierno americano, pero lo que nunca nos van a quitar es la alegría.
Enviarle un mensaje al presidente de los Estados Unidos, Joe Biden, para este 2022, ¿cuál sería?
Pedirle que nos quite el bloqueo.
Ellos en sus cosas y nosotros en la nuestra, cada cual a lo suyo.
Es mucho lo que hay que decirle a ese señor, pero bueno, que acabe de levantar el bloqueo, que no joda tanto.
Que cese el bloqueo. Que nos deje desarrollarnos, a ver si es un país fallido o no lo es.
Ojalá se acabara el bloqueo, y verán cosas mejores para Cuba.
¿Entonces espera cambios en respecto a la política de Biden para el 2022?
No sé, porque son tantos años de injusticia que ya yo no confío ni en Biden ni en el que venga atrás. Ahí republicano y demócrata es la misma cosa.
Espera del 2022.
Prosperidad y salud para todos los cubanos.
Esperanza, según nos dice el presidente, que para enero hay mejoría.
¿Cree usted que podamos tener un feliz año nuevo?
Claro, sí, ya la mayoría de todos estamos vacunados, los niños y todo.
Y ojalá que esto se componga para que sigamos sigamos alegres.
Well, thank you very much for showing that video and for inviting me on. And I wanted to thank Helen, always so so right on spot when it comes to Cuba. I wanted to speak a little bit about the last 7-8 years when it comes to U.S. policy towards Cuba, because it's been quite a roller coaster. I mean, as Helen was saying, and as I'm sure most of you know, the blockade has been in place for 6 decades, right? And it's been very consistent throughout. And the only, I would say, the biggest change it's been, at least in some positive direction, came in the last couple of years of Barack Obama's presidency. This did not mean, and I always like to make this clear because a lot of people get confused, Barack Obama did not lift the embargo for a couple of years, okay? The embargo was still in place and all of those laws that Helen was speaking about were still there. Now, what he did do was cut and loose some of those restrictions that it is in his power to do so when it came to travel, when it came to some forms of trade. So that was good. Don't get me wrong, but I just want to make clear, the embargo was still on. However, people in Cuba were benefited by this slight change. Just think about how beneficial it would have been if it would completely disappear overnight. With the very small things that he did, Cuba did prosper. A lot of tourism started putting in the country, and tourism, believe me, has become very, very important for Cuban economy over the last couple of decades. And not just that, I could see the people were more hopeful, because this has been the one big issue we've had for more than half a century. You know, so when people saw that things were loosening up, you could see joy. That joy that you saw in that video, multiply that. Because we're only used to the bad coming from the United States. You know, this has been the constant reality for us. Okay, let's see what they do now. You know, let's see what the other guy does now. So then fast forward to, elections in 2016, and Donald Trump wins. And soon after that, he did not only take back the steps taken by Barack Obama, but he also imposed a whole new set of sanctions. And I'm saying more than 200 of them. And not just random, they were very targeted sanctions. I was glad to hear Helen mention the Lester Mallory quote from 1960, which speaks about, you know, that the goal of US policy should be to bring about hunger and despair for the Cuban people to get to a regime change. And I bring that up again because that is precisely what you could see with Trump's policies towards Cuba. They targeted all of Cuba's lifelines, you know, tourism, you name it, remittances. We're talking about such an expansive set of measures that there wasn't one area of Cuban society or Cuban economy that you could not see impacted by this policy more than it already is by the standard blockade. Tourism is a sector I can particularly speak about because with that boom of tourism, many of us joined that sector, me included, and I saw firsthand how many people lost their jobs and lost their money because of all the regulations that were imposed in that department. And this is particularly contradictory because entrepreneurs and the private sector in Cuba, it is the one group of people in Cuba that are always used as a banner by U.S. politicians. So this is the people that we have to help out. This is the people that are going to thrive once the evil regime is gone, right? But those are the people that felt the consequences of Trump's policies first, I would say, because the majority of them were focused on precisely on tourism. Now, I wanted to speak a little bit about Trump sanctions, not just leave it hanging there and explain a little bit. So there's already a lot that the blockade does in itself without the necessity of more, you know, sanctions by a president. As Helen was saying, it is extraterritorial. It prevents foreign investment from coming to Cuba. Actually, I would say that sometimes I think that the biggest harm that the U.S. blockade does to Cuba's economic relations is not the deals that it hurts while they're happening. It's all the business that it prevents from happening altogether, because those are the ones that, you know, never get to happen, never get to improve life in Cuba. So they targeted that. I wanted to mention one in particular, because right before Trump left office, he put Cuba back on the state sponsors of terrorism list. And this has been catastrophic, the consequences of it for Cuba, because banks now, many of them feel that if they're doing business with Cuba, they could be sanctioned because they're doing business with a terrorist country. And look, even the biggest detractor of the Cuban government should be know enough to acknowledge that the Cuban government is not terrorist, okay? Like, whatever you can say about them, they're not sponsoring terrorists. So this is just the newest in a long line of actions to prevent foreign investment. And it certainly has done precisely that over the last couple of years. Now I myself was one of the many that was rooting for anyone to win the election in 2020. So I could say that I witnessed many people celebrate Biden's victory, you know, waiting to see what happened with those last couple of states. Hey, what's going on? Maybe he'll win or he'll not win. Because at that point, we were like, anyone should be better than Trump. You know, we cannot take another 4 years of this guy. But, you know, naive as we were, you know, Biden had said he would change policy, but he took a long time to do the very little things that he's just doing right now. Over the last year and a half, what we've seen from President Joe Biden has been just leaving everything that Trump imposed, just leaving it right in place, including the state sponsored terrorism list, which means that in practice, Biden's policy towards Cuba has pretty much been Trump's policy towards Cuba. Now, when that long period of policy review was, as the administration called it, finished, what came is just small loosening up on travel, on remittances. And these are good things, don't get me wrong. These are good things, it's better than what we had. However, it's not nearly enough, because the embargo remains in place and the majority of Trump sanctions remain in place. And Cuba's economic relations remain harmed, hindered by the overall policy of the United States towards the country. And not just that, I think it's also particularly infuriating for us, because what you hear in their rhetoric is that whatever they're doing, and I'm not just talking about the administration, whichever administration came before, is we're doing all of this to help the Cuban people. The embargo, the blockade does not affect the people. It is built to affect the government, who is repressing the people and we need to get rid of them. And the size of this lie is so big that you don't even know where to start to dismount it. And the fact that so many people go with it, it's just sad. So that's why the focus of our work at Belly of the Beast, which is a media organization I'm very proud to be a part of, is try to take down those lies. First of all, because it is impossible to affect a government and not the people, because governments provide services for the people. In the case of Cuba, the size of those services is quite large. It includes education, it includes health, two of the most important things. So if you're by the time you're affecting the Cuban government, capacity to do business normally, you are, in fact, just affecting the people that government represents and provides services for. Now, even beyond that, a lot of the sanctions put in place have been targeted at the people and not at the government. Remittances don't affect the government. Remittances affect the people that have, you know, the million plus people that have families in the US and cannot send remittances to Cuba, those are the ones affected. It's not the government. Sure, the government will have less money circling on its streets, but it's the people that suffer consequences for that. So I think I'm getting close to the time, so I'm just gonna give the message that I think we should be happy that some measures are being taken from the Biden administration to loosen up travel, remittances, and hopefully a lot more. But that should not blind us into thinking they are doing anything for the sake of the Cuban people. And that should not blind us to thinking that they're down the right track. They're doing the right thing. Oh, they're not so bad. No, because they are consistently and knowingly hurting people in Cuba. You know, they're hurting Cuban families. You know, I'm sure anyone that you meet in Cuba can tell you how hard the last couple of years have been, the scarcities, the lines and all of it. And Cuba is a nuanced place, and there are problems that are internal and there are things that we need to work on. But that does not diminish, that does not make the influence and the impact of your sanctions any smaller. I wanted just to mention one thing, because rarely you find, because the embargo and the blockade is so comprehensive and broad, sometimes it's hard to explain it in little things because it impacts everything. But I think that the vaccine and COVID, Cuba's COVID response is the one of the best examples you can find. Cuba has developed its own vaccines to fight COVID in this complicated period of time. And there was one of these vaccines in particular, the Soberana, which means sovereign, that was going to be the one that vaccinated the Western half of the country. And the production of that vaccine depended on some raw materials that the company that provided them decided not to sell to Cuba. You know, they had to do a whole review of that process of selling it to Cuba because of the embargo, because of the sanctions imposed by the United States, and because of Cuba being in the state sponsored terrorism list. So I think this is one moment in which you can say that the United States blockade cost Cuban lives, because this slowed down Cuba's COVID response, which had to wait for Abdallah, the other vaccine, to then vaccinate the people in that region. And in that period of time, Cuba's COVID numbers rise and people die. So I think this is why it is so important to bring this up, because perhaps not every sanction is going to cost someone their life like it did with COVID, but they're certainly going to make people's life more difficult. And you know, at the end, I think the Cuban people, we whatever we say about the Cuban government, we hate the United States government, but we can always find common ground with the people, you know, and that's what it's all about. I think that if the people in the United States knew all of this that we're talking about here, all of the things that a lot of you are aware of, there wouldn't be a blockade. I'm confident in that, you know, because it's just irrational that it would be a different way. So on that note, you know, I just finished with that. Spread the word.
Thank you very much, Daniel. One of the things I love about the Belly of the Beast's work is the focus on the lives of daily Cubans. And I think your final words of, if people in the United States knew more about this, that there would be no blockade, is exactly the task that is ahead of us all here tonight. So with that, we will move on to the question and answer portion of our program. And my colleague, Judy, from July 26th, will take over.
Great, thanks, Steve. And thanks so much to Helen and Danielle. Wonderful talks. Yes, so I'm with the Boston Cuban Solidarity Coalition, also known as the July 26th Coalition. And we're very excited to have you all on. We have, I think at this point, about almost 130 people on. So thank you all for joining us. And thanks to, we've got some great questions. What we'll do is we'll raise the questions to both Danielle and Helen. And we'd like to have some dialogue between the two of you, especially because you know each other as well. But I wanted to pick on one question that really follows, Danielle, what you were talking about. And this question talks about how in many ways Biden has made things worse, even compared to Trump around the US blockade. And this person was interested in what's the understanding of Cubans about the latest sanctions, particularly from the Biden administration, because in many ways it does seem continuing to be worse. As you've talked about, some people here had high hopes for Biden, and now there doesn't seem to be much difference at all. If not, it's gotten worse. And Helen, you can respond to that as well. Danielle?
You want to go first, Helen, or should I?
I think this is for you, mate.
Okay. Well, it's hard to measure, right? Because it's we're talking policies, and I think what makes Biden worse, in my view, is the hypocrisy, you know. Because you know, we knew at that point, you know, as Trump's time in office happened, you know, we kind of knew what to expect. I mean, they've always found a way to surprise us with a new way to make our lives more hard, but it was very consistent. What made Biden particularly disappointing was the fact we were expecting something different. You know, being Obama's vice president, we thought, okay, so you know, it is possible to have a return to that way of doing things. So when that didn't happen, and that has not happened, even if small steps have been taken forward, that was particularly disappointing. However, when it comes to the actual policies, I mean, the fact remains that what Biden did was just keeping Trump's policies, Trump's sanctions in place. After the July 11th protests in Cuba, he did impose some what I would call symbolic sanctions, because they targeted Cuban government officials and police and stuff like that, that would already have been impacted by the overall sanctions, right, of the blockade itself, which limits many things that come to the Cuban government or to the Cuban Communist Party. So Biden's one big sanction has been to keep all of Trump's in place in that sense.
Great. Thanks, Danielle. Helen, do you want to...
Yeah, I think what happened was that Trump, as we know, you went for a maximum pressure tactic, and he really tried to fulfill this proposal by Lester Mallory back on the 6th of April 1960, right? Let's create hunger, desperation, and overthrow of government. And so, you know, that was what they were pushing at, and accompanied by huge social media campaign, which became more effective when workplaces and study centers were closed down in Cuba. So the normal channels or forums that Cubans have to discuss, debate, interact, were closed down because Cuba was very strict from an epidemiological perspective. And so social media, you know, these sophisticated programs, part of the broader democracy promotion, so-called programs that are funded overtly by 20 million approved through the US Congress every year. 20 million, you know, if you think about, that's more than a million per, that's almost 2 million per Cuban, right? So, anyway, I just want to say it's nearly 1 o'clock in the morning, so excuse my maths. but the point is that they this was what Trump was going for, and it he left and it hadn't been fulfilled. But obviously Biden, Biden had advisors that were saying it's working, right? We keep compounding that pressure. 243 new action sanctions and coercive measures during the Trump administration, more than 50 of them during the pandemic, when the UN and other international bodies were saying, please roll back sanctions that interrupt, that obstruct a country's capacity to deal with this global health pandemic. And they, you know, they really did obstruct Cuba's capacity in so many ways. Daniel was given the example. The other example, which was directly linked to the protests in the summer, was that Cuba's oxygen plant broke down, you know, and the US refused to sell parts. So that's another direct link between lives lost in Cuba and US sanctions. So what it seems obvious that Biden was advised that this policy of maximum pressure was close to success and they should keep squeezing and keep going. And they had the 11th of July protests. And they, because, you know, there's so much ignorance of Cuban history, of Cuban politics, of Cuban people, of Cuban resilience, right? There's so much ignorance. I mean, we talked when we before we came in, the meeting started about, you know, it's Che Guevara, the anniversary, it's Che Guevara's birthday today. We commemorate that. But it's also the birthday of Antonio Maceo, right, who's known as the Bronze Titan, an incredible man in Cuba's struggle for independence. And if there was anyone who was a testimony to Cuban resistance and resilience, the importance of focus on sovereignty and social justice, right, it would be Maceo. So, you know, the US, they don't know about this stuff, right? They have a new administration, they have a couple of officials who read a guidebook. I remember Ricardo Alarcón telling me how they used to turn up to these meetings, whether it was secret negotiations or public ones, of this guidebook, and they couldn't engage in any conversation without checking what the guidebook said. That, you know, he said you'd ask them about the weather and they'd be like, what does the guidebook say? So, you know, real serious ignorance about the Cuban people and their struggle. And, you know, really believed that the 11th of July represented a moment of existential crisis. It was shocking for Cubans. It was shocking for Cuba. It was the first violent national protest in Cuba for 60 years, but it was not an existential crisis. So, you know, the Biden administration was hanging on and hoping. And I think, and this links to another question that's coming up in the chat, why did they roll back on that a little bit? And as Daniel said, the new announcements by Biden about being able to send more remittances, about family reunification program, which is just very slowly starting, and so on. Those were kind of like emergency measures to try and abate the protests from Latin American countries and heads of state about the way that Biden was continuing the Trump policy on Cuba. So there's a question there about, you know, the countries that didn't send a head of state to the summit of the Americas, which has just taken place in Los Angeles, and, you know, the exclusion of Cuba. Well, that was very significant. And I believe that, you know, that really was part of what pushed Biden into these small steps, superficial measures that Daniel was talking about. So I've kind of jumped ahead and covered another question, but that's what I think is going on. I mean, Biden, even under Obama, right? Obama waited. Let's remember this. Obama did almost nothing for 6 years. It was not until the middle of his second administration. And in the first 6 years before rapprochement was announced, the fines put by OFAC, the Office of Foreign Asset Controls of the US Treasury, against European banks, which are outside US jurisdiction, doesn't matter to them. They use their control over the international financial system. They abuse their control, I should say, over the international financial system. The fines were over $14 billion in those 6 years, just for the big banks. So, you know, now we remember Obama. Oh, Obama took a move. You know, as Daniel said as well, he did not lift the blockade. He said, I want it lifted. He didn't even have the courage to take the fight to Congress. And that's the only way it can be lifted. So, you know, what he did is he signed some executive decrees, and Trump came along and said, all of those decrees he signed can be reversed. That's what I'm going to do. Then he won the vote in Florida. You know, that's what that announcement was followed by massive campaign contributions from the right wing Cuban American community. And that's what this is about. And you can track sanctions, the increase in sanctions and the US presidential electoral cycle. In fact, there's a Cuban historian of US-Cuba relations who's publishing work on this, producing the data, Ernesto Dominguez Lopez, who's showing how these things track together.
Thank you, Helen and Danielle. And thanks for responding to some of the other questions. That's great. So there were a number of questions about the economy, and this is a question for both of you. And the first is around the emphasis on the tourist industry that you both talked about. And the question is, in what ways does Cuba hope to diversify the economy, given that it's been so much focused on the tourist industry? Can either of you speak to that?
I can reply to that. I like the economic ones. Yeah, basically, I mean, the first thing to say is that Cuba never wanted tourism post-1959. Tourism is associated with the, you know, 1950s period of humiliation, national humiliation, exploitation, and so on. You know, when Havana was like, you know, a playground, as it's been described, for US business people, brothels, prostitution, casinos, massive inequality between Havana and the rest of the island. So tourism became a big part of Cuba's international trade in the special period, because it was something that the Cubans could do in the whole process of restructuring their economy to reintegrate into a capitalist global economy with no special deals like they had through the Council of Mutual Economic Assistance. So tourism has been reluctantly introduced, and it has been very carefully managed, because they didn't want to develop the kind of cheap sex tourism industry that you see in lots of parts of the world. And they now have quite a lot of emphasis on ecotourism, cultural tourism, and so on. So just to be clear, that even the development of the tourist industry is in some ways a response, a necessity created by the US blockade, because the US blockade interrupts or obstructs Cuba's capacity to trade normally. And the same can be said for Cuba's biggest source of earnings, which is the export of medical professionals and professional services. And Cuba, again, has been able to do that because of capacity, right? It already has a socialist state investing huge proportion of its GDP in health and education. So it has the doctors, it has the educators. And then by a historical conjunction, the period post 2000, dovetailing with the Bolivarian Revolution in Venezuela, the relationship with Chavez and the Venezuelan government in that period, it naturally sort of developed into an earner for the state, and is in fact the biggest earner for Cuba. But Cuba is working very hard to diversify all of those two sectors, so diversify tourism, diversify the countries that it engages with in terms of medical internationalism, professional services. So it has now contracts with the Middle East and other countries, not just the traditional places where they had medical internationalism, like Africa, like Latin America. So they're diversifying those, but they are also working quite hard to diversify other sectors. Biotechnology is one of the biggest earners of export goods. And obviously, as Cuba comes out of COVID-19 with its COVID vaccine, a COVID vaccine which they have promised to sell to the world at solidarity prices, which quite frankly means to give them away for the poorest countries, and then to have a sliding scale according to the ability of countries to pay, but very, very cheap compared to what the big big pharma companies are going to be charging. So they are trying to diversify, and it's quite incredible, actually. If you look at the their trade partners and the countries they come from, you may be surprised, but it's something they're working on. But their room for maneuver is very limited, again, by the US blockade.
Great, thanks, Helen. Daniel, did you want to jump in on this?
I just wanted to mention something. Honestly, Helen knows about this much more than me. But also, an important part of what she's saying is that internally there is a big push for the private sector, you know, to develop. And what I mean is that there's a lot of categories that have been approved and favored by the government to start a small or medium business. You know, and a huge amount of the working population in Cuba now has shifted to the private sector, which is just another way that found, you know, for the country to develop, and which has been very important for many people over the last decade or so since this whole process started. And that is also an important part of that equation that Helen was describing.
Great. Thanks, Daniel. So we have a great question from Don Gerwitz, who's been a longtime solidarity activist. So I'm going to read his question because it's quite different from some of the others. So many have blamed the Cuban rightists in Miami for US policy historically and now. He thinks the US policy is determined by the US and the Miami Cuban rightists are convenient justification for US policy, which flows 100% from those who own, control, and run the US government. These interests cannot and will not tolerate Cuba's revolutionary example as a legitimate, workable alternative to the capitalist exploitation and oppression that prevails in the rest of the underdeveloped world. What is your opinion about the relationship between the powerful Cuban rightists and US policy? A long question, but good one.
Yeah, look, there's several parts to that answer because, I mean, at the moment the blockade was born, you know, we're talking about the height of the Cold War. And obviously, that's where this whole thing starts to develop. Cuba ends up aligning itself with the Soviet Union after being for, all the way to the beginning of the 20th century, a colony or a neo-colony of the United States. So the birth of the blockade has to do with an ideological issue, right? So, and also, I do believe that that it is an important part of the why, the fact that Cuba does offer an alternative to the way things are done in the United States. However, it is impossible to leave aside the pressure from right-wing Cuban Americans, particularly in Florida. You know, the Cuban lobby was born in the 1980s. So for the first 20 years of what we know as the blockade, there wasn't a pressure from a lobby, because that lobby did not exist. These people had gotten to the United States hoping to just have, they were gonna be for a small period of time, so the revolution would end and they would come back and regain everything. Once it became clear that was not going to happen, the lobby begins in the 1980s. And yes, and that is the process and the period of time where you can see a lot of money being put behind policy, actual policy towards Cuba. It comes to fruition, to realization in the 1990s under Clinton's, particularly with Torricelli and the Helms-Burton Act. So those two are the ones that today we're saying the embargo cannot be lifted without a congressional action, not just the presidential, is precisely because Clinton let that happen in the 1990s. And behind that, those laws, you have the direct influence of right-wing Cuban Americans. Now, when it comes to the 21st century, it gets a little bit more complicated than that, because at this point in time, the lobby is in the politicians. So the lobby has diminished significantly, right? There isn't this major force that it was back then. But you have people like Marco Rubio or Bob Menendez that are the lobby and the politician at the same time, whose whole existence and political campaigns and line of donations, and a lot of it depends on this position towards Cuba and on manipulating people when it comes to the Cuba issue. So that's why I think that at this point in time, it's more complicated because they have melted into one, the lobby and the politicians are the same thing in many ways. That does not mean that you don't have people pushing for tough on Cuba policies just from the lobby side. But you, the fact remains that you already have people in very important high places within the United States government that are pushing for this themselves and that have, you know, leverage. You know, you have before, I mean, all of Trump's Cuba policy was dictated by, in many ways, by Marco Rubio, who held such an important position within the Foreign Affairs Committee. And then that place was taken over by Bob Menendez. So we're like, there's no escape from these guys. You know, we went from one to the other. You got a Republican and a Democrat. It's all the same, you know. So yeah, I'm just going to let Helen jump in a little bit.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Thanks, Daniel. Helen?
I think that was a really interesting answer. And I agree with everything that Daniel said. And I would just add that the big success of the Cuban exile community or Cuban Americans, whatever you want to call them, has been the capacity to turn the United States Cuba policy into domestic policy. And I think he explained the process, how that works. And, you know, like Marco Rubio, he's giving the example, got himself onto, I believe, a three-person committee to investigate the links between Trump and Russia funding. So, you know, they're very, very strategic, very, very careful and clever. But I do also appreciate the question. And the question is, you know, the question is also saying we need to recognize that Cuban socialism is a threat to US capitalism, right? And that's true. However, the main piece of legislation that was that sustains the blockade is the Trading with the Enemy Act, which is a 1917 act. And Cuba is the only country in the world that remains subject to the imposition of the TWEA. And so, you know, the United States hasn't had a problem having rapprochement and diplomatic relations and trade and ending blockades with other socialist and communist countries. Now, we can debate the extent to which they really are socialists and communists, but I think, you know, clearly that is an issue that we shouldn't underestimate. We shouldn't just put it down to a lobby. And your question says, you know, isn't it a convenient justification? I mean, the fact that Cuba is in Latin America, which is the United States' historical backyard, or as Biden tried to say, it's not our backyard, it's our front yard. You know, as if it's a yard, unbelievable. But you know, the fact that it's in that region does mean that socialism in Latin America and the Caribbean is a specific ideological and political threat to the United States. And you know, we can see what they did to crush other attempts to build socialism in Chile, in Nicaragua, what they have subjected the Venezuelan people to, you know, sanctions that have, I mean, a report 2 years ago or something estimated that they had cost the lives of 100,000 Venezuelans. And, you know, and I just want to say something, because touching on this, when Danielle was talking about sanctions, you know, proving that sanctions kill in Cuba's case. I mean, actually, the reason this is an issue is because the Cuban state has been so good at focusing resources to save lives and prioritizing saving lives and coming up with all inventive solutions to find one supplier for that magic medicine that will keep, you know, six children alive. And you know, there are many examples of that, that it has allowed people to say, oh, the blockade doesn't, you know, affect Cubans. But if you look at the sanctions that were imposed on Iraq, yeah, they were less extensive, and they are noted by the UN as having been responsible for the death of 150 children every day. So I think we should also be clear, if Cuba didn't have its centralized socialist state, which could plan, which could channel resources, which didn't have to negotiate with private interests, then you would see a lot more devastation in human terms from the blockade. And I know that was not anything to do with your question, but it was a point that I wanted to make.
Great, thanks, Helen. So we are actually at our time to move on, but I'm sorry we didn't get to some of the many other great questions Maybe what we can do is send these to Daniel and Helen, and perhaps they can respond at a later point. But I think at this point, I will pass it back to Diane and Steve, and really want to thank our two speakers for your great responses to all of these questions. So Diane and Steve?
Yeah. So thank you. Thank you both so much for tremendous information. And it's leading right into what I have to say right now, which is that although Cuba has done an amazing, amazing job with vaccinating population, almost the entire country is vaccinated. Children over the age of 2 are vaccinated. And yet there are pieces of the medical system that Cuba is struggling to be able to provide. We were able to help a little bit with the Saving Lives campaign. We raised $650,000 to send syringes to Cuba to help with providing vaccinations for people who needed them. There's something else, and I hope all of you will listen carefully, because this is something, if you're, hopefully you're motivated and thinking, what can I do to help Cuba? And here's something very specific that you can do to help. I'm going to talk to you about the Calixto Garcia Hospital, which is the major trauma hospital for Cuba. It has 23 operating rooms and only 2 functioning anesthesia machines right now. They desperately need help. They need anesthesia machines. They need sutures. They need surgical supplies. And we are raising funds in order to provide this for them. We are doing this through Global Health Partners and the Saving Lives campaign. They are launching a broad-based drive to supply Cuba with these desperately needed medical supplies. In the chat, you will see the link to Global Health Partners where you can send a donation, please, any amount, because we're trying to raise $125,000 to send these anesthesia machines to Cuba so that they can perform operations and do the life-saving that they have always been able to do. So please show your support. The information is in the chat. It will be also sent out to you after this. If you can make a donation, it would be a tremendous, tremendous help to Cuba, which has provided. We're asking you to show solidarity to a country that has done so much, not only for the health of its own people, but for the struggling communities all around the world. And Cuba has been there for them. And at the beginning of the blockade, they sent people to Italy to help them. And they need help now. So we would very much appreciate any kind of donation that you're able to give to Cuba. And the link is in the chat, and it will be sent out to you afterwards also. And the money is going through Global Health Partners. Bob Schwartz has done an amazing, amazing amount of work to help Cuba. And we would like to see if we can contribute something towards that effort right now. So thank you very much. Okay, I think, Susan, you are up.
What an amazing evening. Thank you both. Thank you, Helen. Thank you, Daniel, from the bottom of my heart. I'm delighted. It's an amazing, amazing evening. Thanks. I'm here to say that how can you get engaged? I mean, in the beginning of our webinar tonight, Judy was telling us that over 120 people joined us tonight for this wonderful webinar. So hopefully you all have connections with Cuban solidarity groups. And I'm here just to say how to get involved. If you have been busy and you want to really understand Cuba and help Cuba, and you just heard about what Diane said, how you can donate, and now how you can get involved. How can you plan webinars, trips to Cuba, bringing books to people to read about Cuba and watch documentaries about Cuba? So there are different ways. For instance, you can work on city council resolutions. We from the July 26th coalition, we are celebrating this week. We are thrilled to say that we just passed a town resolution here in Brookline, Massachusetts, thanks to the relentless efforts of one of the July 26th members, Peter Miller. And we heard that 146 town meeting members from Brookline voted in favor or often blocking Cuba, of saying no to the blockade and this criminal blockade. So this is amazing, this is sensational. And we can also work on labor union resolutions. And here in Massachusetts too, along with Massachusetts Peace Action, MAPA, and the First Baptist Church in Jamaica Plain, we are working on to have the Boston City Council to pass a resolution against the blockade on Cuba. So about this, heads up, because we will have a public hearing at the end of June. So let's organize for this hearing together. And you can also join us, the July 26th Coalition. We are www.july26.org, or you can find us info at july26.org. And if we are not in Massachusetts, you can also get involved if you join, for instance, the local Cuban solidarity groups in your area, in your countries, home countries, or you can join the NNOC, which is the National Network on Cuba, nnoc.info. We have a lot happening in June. In the end of the month, we also gonna have the Cuban ambassador, Liana Torres Rivera, visiting Massachusetts, and we're gonna have a few events. So please go to our webpage, go to our Facebook page, and learn about how can you meet with the ambassador and hear more from, about Cuba. And you can also join, for instance, like Steve, you can join the DSA. So you can have dsausa.org/join, or you can get involved in the DSA's struggle against the blockade, which is the bit.ly/DSA Cuba. I'm gonna write those down. Thanks, Steve, for writing them down. And ask us, how can you get involved? We have a lot of work to do.
Diane, you're on mute.
I knew it. I knew I would be on mute. Sorry. Well, what an evening. Thank you to our speakers. You have both been so not only informative, but insightful in a way that we can't get from anywhere else. And I just want to encourage people to look for other resources, which we will send out to you, because the mainstream media, you are never going to get the truth about the Cuban reality. So please look for the email that we are going to be following up. It's going to have information about other resources for you. And again, if you can contribute anything towards the anesthesia machines that we're trying to send to Cuba, it will mean the world to the people there who need it. And I just want to thank everybody for attending, and thank you. Good night. Anything else I've left out? I think that's it.
Thank you so much.
se aplazó por un momento.
Un breve lapso del tiempo, del universo, un segundo.
Sin embargo, parecía que todo se iba a acabar con la distancia mortal que separó nuestras vidas.
Estar en la lava es unir nuestras manos, estar de ser hermanos, nos miramos con temor.
Cuando pasaron los años se acumularon rencores, se olvidaron los amores, parecíamos extraños. Qué distancia tan sufrida, qué mundo tan separado, jamás se hubiera encontrado sin aportar nuevas vidas. Por una parte, servil y criado por la otra, es lo primero que nota, el último en desatarse. Ejemplo para otros por liberar, la nueva labor fue aislar, bloqueando toda experiencia.
Lo que brilla con luz propia, nadie lo puede apagar, su brillo puede alcanzar la oscuridad de otras costas.
Que pagará este pesar del tiempo que se perdió, de las vidas que costó, de las que puede costar. Lo pagará la unidad de los pueblos en cuestión, del que niegue esa razón, la historia condenará. La historia lleva su carro y a muchos nos montará, por encima pasará de aquel que quiera llegar. Bolívar lanzó una estrella que junto a Martillo Fidel la dignificó para andar por estas tierras. Bolívar lanzó una estrella que junto a Martillo dignificó para andar por estas tierras.
Thank you all once again. This was a fantastic evening, and we look forward to struggling with you against the blockade of Cuba. Good night.